Okay, so before I start, actually, I'll just give you a background. We are, as Patrick has said, we are a school in Mumbai, and actually we started in the year somewhere around 1991 with liberalization. That's the time when actually education in India was liberalized. They allowed private initiatives in education to come in, and we are a private school. And from there on, our primary attempt, especially I won't go much into detail of what our attempts were, and primarily we have been looking at architecture and trying to locate it in the field of cultural studies. And generally in India, architecture is always considered as a part of technology. Not that we don't ask the questions of technology in while we put it in the field of cultural studies, but we ask the question from the field of cultural studies regarding technology. So that's our attempt, and our school has a, we closely work with what I would say is a practice orientation. We have a research cell, and the research cell informs the studios of the project. So it's an architectural school. Studio is the major component there. So a lot of our research projects informs the studios, what the students are involved in, and what it happens also, it gives the students a practice orientation towards real issues of the city. So what I show you is a combination of students' work. I show you some of our research projects that we are involved in, and research projects, as you will see, some we are involved with exchanges with schools all over the world. But the theme I'm talking on today is called learning from informality. So that's what I would talk on. So I would talk on, like, just to explain the context of Mumbai, before, like, 10 years from now, earlier, 10 years earlier, Mumbai had 65% of its population staying in informal settlements, and 35% of its population in formal settlements. But just to also give you another fact, the 65% of the people which are staying were staying in 8% of the land. So 8% of the land was occupied by these informal settlements. 65% of the people were staying there. 92% means roads, formal settlements, big housing, expensive housing, and infrastructure. So that's what it would be. So over the last 10 years, obviously the slum, like generally the spatial nature of the slums have changed, which I'll show you also. And that also has changed how much percentage have become informal. So that's what I will show you. And it's a big issue. The government wants to deal with informality, primarily as any government would in anywhere in the world. So they look at it as a problem. They look at it as saying that it needs to be addressed. Something needs to be done about it. They need to be resettled. They need to be given new housing. So let us understand what is the state's imagination in the beginning, and from there we will go to how our projects, our interactions with the notion of informality, what learnings have we learned from there. So some of the projects we will show you actually are some research projects that we have taken, and what are learnings from these projects. So first I'll start with the city context in Mumbai, and how the city visions itself, especially after globalization, that's what the city believes it should do. That's our Prime Minister. In 2005, he had visited Shanghai. That's Dr. Manmohan Singh. He's the father of liberalization. He's the main person of liberalization in our economy. So he became the Prime Minister, and he had gone to Shanghai, and that's what he said, that when we talk about a resurgent India, he's impressed by the great changes that have happened in Shanghai, and he aspires to transform Mumbai into Shanghai. So that's what he calls it, and so that's the Times of India reporting, like showing how reality is, how what it is here, what you see down, that's reality, and that's what would become, the vision would become what you see here. And he's called the urbanator. And that's again the Times of India reporting. That's what the imagination would be. That's the Mumbai island that you see. This is the mainland. And this whole Mumbai region would be characterized by new airports. So this is the airport here now. They'd be characterized by new airports, new ports, new connectors from the mainland. Something called the SEZ, very much a model learned from China. These are special economic zones, big manufacturing areas that would form, mainly private in nature, that would form the landscape of the city. And that's how this region would be driven. It would become the international finance center of the country. It is already a finance center, so it would become the international finance center of the country. And to this imagination, they were clear that two major things they were actually grappling with. One is informal settlements, and one is also many poor people staying in rented properties. Because in India, if you know the context, the rents had been frozen after independence. The rents had been frozen with a reason to actually provide affordable housing to people who were renting in those old part of the city. And what had happened, because of the rents being frozen, the owners had lost interest and the buildings were dilapidating. So now when you see the old city of Mumbai, lot of structures undergoing dilapidation, falling down with monsoons. So that's another big problem for the city planners. So they were clear that they would have some policy to address these two issues. One is informality, and one is people staying in tenanted properties. So in both of these projects, we have been engaging the government. Not that we have been told by the government to build plans for this, not at all. In fact, I'll tell you now what we did, actually. A lot of the projects of the informal settlements, the government had a landmark project which was like actually characterized by this big redevelopment project called the Dharavi redevelopment project, which would be to actually redevelop a huge slum which is considered to be Asia's largest, and completely redevelop it and with private initiatives. So that was the reason with which we entered. So I'll show you some bit of start you with the Dharavi redevelopment project, and I'll give you the context of this. So as we were engaging, the 2004 the government actually had proposed this project, the Dharavi redevelopment project, and as we were engaging with the government, once the proposal came out, we were saying that this project, the way the government has conceived, is not done. It's not the way it should be done. The government was saying that they would call in, they would divide Dharavi into five sectors, and these five sectors, they would call five international bidders, and they would bid each sector, and they would redevelop these areas. They would rehabilitate the people in high-rise tall towers, and the rest of the land, they would give it to the builders to actually look for commercial profits. So that would be offices, that would be expensive apartments that would come up in these informal settlements. So that's how they were conceiving the project. And our main premise to the government was, this is not people driven. You are not considering this whole issue of people who are getting rehabilitated. You don't understand the history of these people in that area. And you cannot have such a... So first of all, and we were not only the college, no way. We were a group of, the college was there. There were powerful non-governmental organizations. There were also experts there. So first of all, the government said, no way, we are going ahead. So we wrote a letter to the Prime Minister. And that's a time when the government, the Prime Minister said clearly that this group should be heard. You should take them into just to hear what they have to say. And so then we were made a part of an advisory group to the Dharavi project. So actually we could look at the process of bidding. We were actually looking at the part of how the technical bids were being made. So I'm going to show you one of the part of the proposals of one of the bidders. I'm not naming anybody here, but I'm showing you one of the part of the proposals done by one of the developers. The genetic remains the same. All the projects actually were proposing the same thing. And the designs were different, but I'll show you what actually the projects were about. So that's Dharavi, as you see. So as you can see, that brown area, this area is Dharavi, and it's a very important location. You can see the grain of this place. That's the informal settlement. All this you can see here, it's formalized. All formal housing surrounded by formal housing. Also, it has got three main railway corridors. Three main railway corridors of actually Mumbai meet here. So one, you have the Western Railway here in the green star stations, the Central Railway and the Harbour Railway. So Dharavi sits in a very important transport junction. And just opposite to Dharavi is the International Finance and Business District. So so you can understand why this place is so important. So it's a cost expensive piece of real estate. So that's why the interest around Dharavi became so important. And there were bidders also wanting to. So what do they propose? Let's see. So those are the important connectors, important road connectors, the important rail connectors in blue, the connectors inside Dharavi. So just to give you, so that's the builder's presentation. What they do is they show what Dharavi is presently and what they would like Dharavi to be. And this, as you can see, could be anywhere. This could be in Vancouver, in London, it could be Mumbai, it could be anywhere actually. That's the type of building type that they talk about Dharavi would get replaced by, and that's what they think Dharavi should be. And that's the plan for Dharavi. Just to give you one example, that this, it would be replaced by landmark buildings. So if any architecture students here would start recognizing these buildings, so all would be in Dharavi. So that's what they imagined. So that's what the developers were planning, that Dharavi should be one of the examples of good architecture in the city. And that's what we were trying to oppose. In fact, that's what we were working with. We were telling the government that this is not actually the way to go forward. And we were telling them why this is not the way to go forward. I'll show you in the next slide. Just to give you an example of also how, because Dharavi itself has not seen too much of redevelopment, but just to give you an idea of what it would look like. So this is a small project, a slum redevelopment project, which has been done in the western suburbs, a costly piece of real estate of slum redevelopment. Just to show you that how rehabilitation buildings are conceived here. So that's rehabilitation. You can see the distance between buildings and the length of buildings. A lot of them don't get light and ventilation. And these being rehabilitation buildings, these are the apartments which are for commercial sale. So that's how, that would be the genetics of this development, that that's what was getting proposed in Dharavi. So these are very expensive apartments, maybe four-bedded apartments, three-bedded apartments that would be sold in the open market. But that's what, which was being conceived for Dharavi. Just to give you an example of this whole notion of informality and informal housing, how the government has looked into it for the last, from 1970 to 2014. 1970, all slums were considered illegal. They have to be removed. That's what they were looked at. But slowly and steadily, with a lot of pressures from citizens group, they changed that. The government said, no, we can't remove them. You have to improve them. So improvement was first brought in. 1991 is exactly when liberalization happens, and that's when private funding in slum redevelopment comes in. And what you see is actually the example of Dharavi comes, the Dharavi redevelopment project comes in 2004. So that's what the governments have been actually changing the discourse of how their discourse has changed, and a lot has happened because of pressure group created by citizens, not because of that the government has had revelations that they should change their ideas. Okay, so what we have been looking at, just to give you an example, how we were engaging the government, we were actually looking at old maps, and we're looking at the history of Dharavi through these old maps. And we had maps from 1864, and so Dharavi, which showed Dharavi, actually the railways were built by that time, so you see the two main railway lines which were getting built. And when we're looking at that land, Dharavi was shown as a small fishing village. So this is the creek that you see, and Dharavi was shown as a small fishing village. And to that, the government was quite surprised to know that Dharavi had a fishing village also. And we were looking at maps of 1897, which shows Dharavi still being a fishing village. Then we were looking at maps of 1933, which showed Dharavi growing. And that was a time when a lot of the leather industry was getting shifted to Dharavi. So a lot of industries got shifted here, got shifted from the city to a suburban area, and with the leather industry was clearly a lot of labor population that was required, so that got settled here. So we were saying that the leather industry is still here, and these are formal properties. You can't consider them as like informal settlers. And finally, that was in 1969 that Dharavi grows, and you can see that the low-lying areas is actually the land around it was marshy. All were reclaimed by people. It was not through planned reclamation. And in 1999, you can see that a lot of activities and people have been resettled from the town to this area. So there are actually legal resettlement done in Dharavi. So you can see something called Kumbharwara, which means potters. So potters have been resettled here. Lot of labor colony, you can see the labor colonies here. So they have been resettled from the city. So a lot of resettlements have been done here. So not all is informal. So this is what we were explaining to the government, that this place has a history, and you can't make a generic description that this is an informal settlement. And so the government, this is a plan which the government had prepared, a development plan the government had prepared in 1981, saying that that's how Dharavi should be. This, like any planning exercise, clear zoning, not understanding that this is a rich place, rich of in terms of diversity, multi-use. That's what they were doing. In fact, they had also proposed a redevelopment project. The first time they were trying to understand Dharavi and map Dharavi was try to understand Dharavi and how these things work. So they had mapped the streets, and they saw that there are actually ethnic communities who were organized around the streets. So that's the first mapping that they did. So what they told us, why don't you show us what is the organizational system of Dharavi? So what we did was we actually worked very closely with community-based organizations in Mumbai who have access to Dharavi, and with the community, we actually mapped their territories. We mapped their organizational systems. It was based clearly on the idea of work, on ideas of ethnicity, ideas of religion. So many of these communities organized themselves around that. And we started mapping along with the community, and the community actually was part of the mapping exercise. So just to show you certain organizational systems, so they actually are not cooperative societies, but they emulate the cooperative society. They are informal cooperative societies. And what we did was we actually mapped these and understood how many of them actually are informal, and they have names given to them, though they are informal. We mapped also how many commercial are there, how many residential are there. All these mapping were done with the people, and we made maps with them. So we explained them that a part of Dharavi, it's only a part of Dharavi, has such complexities. Okay, and we went on mapping with them. We showed them that there are other systems called chawls, which are resettled settlements, which are also a part of this. So we mapped all the chawls with the people. So we showed them that that's another level, another layer of complexity which exists. See, nagars are boundaries which are clearly ethnic boundaries. So yeah, they also are there. And there are some clusters which are ambiguous, which don't have this clear definition. So we were trying to explain to them that this is the map of Dharavi. If you need to make any plan, you need to be able to respect this. You need to be able to understand that people have organized themselves in this way. So, and let's see what have they organized towards. You can see the richness of work there. So some of the places involved in making food, a lot of the city actually depends on food being served from Dharavi. So a lot of the office goers depend on this food. So a lot of food gets served in Dharavi. So the leather industry, a very export-oriented industry, a part of Dharavi. In fact, as per a tentative estimate that goes, it's nearly a $0.75 billion industry. That's the turnover per year in terms of the leather industry. That's the potters who make pots, and that's embroidery. So big part of Dharavi is garment and embroidery. So they also form a part, important part of the city. And also recycling. So that's again a very important part. So the question which comes here is, what happens to such activities in cities? Do you erase them? Or can they be part of cities? Or should we remove them? Because generally I know that all of us like cities, like the cities which actually are erased, sanitized. But these activities have to be done somewhere. They are a part of our cities. How do you accommodate them? That's the important question. Do you accommodate all of these into those apartment buildings that I showed you, like those high-rise 13-storied apartment? Yeah, that's the minimum size of housing there, is 300 square feet. Can all be put into that? Because some of them require the ground. So how do they work? So this extreme homogeneous understanding that people have to be pushed into apartment buildings, okay, something we were trying to explain to the government, that your Dharavi could not be able to take these apartments. And if you also give them, they won't work. Probably they will sell and go away. So that's the first question we were asking. How do you recognize the importance of history and community organization in spatial design? So this is one of our research projects that we were involved in. We'll go to the second research project, which we were doing on tenanted properties in the historic area of Mumbai, and how and what is our learning from there. Again, this is the historic district of the city. Just to give you an understanding, this is where the British had built their settlement, and just north of it is the indigenous settlement. Extremely networked settlements, because both of them were interdependent on each other. Lot of the trade happened through this indigenous settlement, so they bought a lot of the goods from the hinterland, and then the British would actually trade with them. So it's a clearly an interconnected relationship they had. And the state of these settlements now, you can see the buildings are in poor condition. And what the government has done there is proposed redevelopment projects which have such, like, it's a private redevelopment completely through private money. They say that you can tear down these old buildings and you can build these high-rise towers. As you can see, no parking. Distance between buildings, if you can understand, if this multiplies, it cannot create a living environment. Okay, so that's what the type of proposal they were proposing, and that's where we had intervened. As I've said, the condition of structure is very bad there. Sanitation very bad. You can see it's structurally supported, might fall any moment, any monsoon might just get that building down. So that's the type of, but when you look at the activity in this area, it's hugely a rich set of activities. Okay, there are, each of these streets are separate bazaars by themselves. Actually, and these bazaars, they are specialized in themselves. So that's what they look like, and that's what they are. And so you can see the small set of activities that happen, small set of entrepreneurship activity. It's an ecology of entrepreneurship, actually, which takes place, all interdependent on each other. A lot of them artisanal, have a market in the city. People still buy these things, and they have a relationship to the city itself. And if you would like to go for handmade, any of the handmade activities, you would still go here. A lot of people in Mumbai would still go here and actually give them orders. So the question here came is that how do you actually enable different scales of entrepreneurship? Because you see the earlier plans, the imagination of the state. The statist imagination is clear. Big corporates, big money, global capital, that's what should be allowed in the city. But the question is, where do the small entrepreneurs go? And remember, this is extremely required because they have organized themselves, they have evolved themselves. They have actually made their place in the city. So the question which comes here is, how do you incorporate them in the city? Or do you throw them out of the city? That's a very important question for us. That's a learning experience. Then I'll show you a third project in the research cell that we were involved with. This is not like related to housing. This is primarily related to commerce. Like, this is informal commerce in the streets of Mumbai. They are done by hawkers in the streets of Mumbai. And so we were called in because what had happened, just to give you the context, the residents of this place, this is a very busy station called Dadar, which is one of the most important suburban stations of Mumbai, because both the railway lines, the western and central, meet together. So the residents of Dadar, of this station area, had complained to the municipality that actually this informal, the hawking and everything is a nuisance. They create congestion. They create a lot of problems to us. We cannot walk in the street, so they should be removed. And they had gone to the court. And the court had given order that yes, probably it should be reconsidered. And that's when the municipality had called us to see whether, to study whether what was the problem and how it could be resolved. And what we had seen clearly, so that's the station area, just to give you an idea. This is the station railway lines, they run here. So there are exits here, 1, 2, 3 exits. And these are streets coming out from the exits. The whole area has bazaars, as you can see. And these are in different times of the day, some in the morning. It's a vibrant bazaar for flowers and vegetables in the morning that takes this place in the area. So when we studied this place and we realized that it's much more complex than just hawkers. It has got off-street traffic. It's got off-street parking. It has got, so the idea was when we understood that this place actually, and we were studying all these things in detail, we were seeing that actually the problem, lot of the problem is because of off-street parking. And if you remove the parking, if you organize the parking, if you organize the vehicular movement, this hawking can still be done. In fact, that's the proposal we were trying to explain to the government that, yeah, you can actually reduce the road widths. You can actually organize your movement. You can, some of these buildings which can be redeveloped because they're government properties can house parking, and the informal, like the hawkers, can be given space to exist within the city. They don't need to be removed. And so that's what we were trying to explain to them. So, and so a very important question here was, whom does the city belong to? Because you have powerful set of communities, you have communities which can actually negotiate with governments very powerfully, and then you have marginal communities also. So how do you work with these different aspirations? Because cities are always about community conflicts. We have been, in a lot of our projects, we have been facing that. So that's what we had experienced in this project. And in fact, while doing the project also, we were closely working with both the, though none of them agreed with us, but we are closely working with both the organizations. One is the Hawkers Union and also the residents community, to explain to them that both need to give space for to each other to coexist. So that's the way the city can work. Otherwise, the city's social fabric is unnecessarily disturbed. That's what we were trying to explain to them. So now I'll come to some learnings that actually we had from these projects, which are, as I'm saying, they are learnings in formulation, not yet been clearly crystallized. They can go on, they can actually be enlarged. But some of the observations that we had was this, about these complex organizational systems that we observe. So which are community-based, sometimes they have symbiosis, sometimes they are in conflict. Okay, sometimes, and they actually are in evolution and some form of incremental growth. Diverse living systems, just not the idea of apartment blocks and where people can be housed in apartments. So diverse living systems and how they can actually be incorporated in cities, and working systems, as I said, huge amount of entrepreneurship which was there. So just to tell you how actually we took some techniques in mapping and understanding these places. Some of these are very traditionally used by planners, and some of them is to understand through statistics. So I'll show you some of the statistical analysis about this settlement. So we had studied, as I said, Dharavi itself, and we were looking at what a planner, a statistical person would analyze and understand through facts and figures of this place. And actually, when we were looking at certain pockets, as you can see, certain pockets of work that we had analyzed earlier, and I had shown you these pockets of our communities, we had taken them and we looked at each one of them and looked at some things which planners will recognize, architects will also recognize these facts and figures. And we had actually very revealing type of understanding. First of all, these are very high densities. Though they're high densities, the FSIs are low. So it's not that, so when city governments say that you need to increase FSI to house many, many people, that's quite a myth. In fact, it's just the opposite. Low densities can take very, very high densities. In fact, we have found out that people who understand the notion of FSI and FAR, very high FAR, which generally tend to lead to, in a city like Mumbai, tend to lead to premium apartments, have lesser houses. They have lesser densities. So that's something we found out when we did an analysis of facts and figures. And also what we found out is that though these settlements don't have open spaces, but if you look at these very narrow lanes that these are there in these fabrics, you will see that most of these settlements have about 22 to 25% as open lanes and lanes, which is the public realm of these settlements. And which is very revealing because they are pedestrianized and they're public. Generally, the type of the notion of public realm in such settlements, they are against what the state imagines. The state imagines public realms either as gardens, either as playgrounds, but generally in these settlements, it doesn't work like that. So that has been a learning, and this has been learning from facts and figures and analyzing numbers. So that's been very revealing for us. So just to continue with some of the types of open space uses that take place in these lanes and streets. So it's work, living, and recreation always in some sort of a conjunction to each other. And then we had, obviously, like architects, we looked at typology and looked at, made typological observations in such settlements. What we realized is the complexity of settlement types that are there in these areas. Okay, some are leased, some are owned. Okay, and they always replicate the formal in some way, and they create this land ecology of rich understanding of ownerships that are there. Okay, just to show you one, this is a jeans manufacturing unit, and a lot of the jeans brand names which get manufactured in Dharavi. Just to show you how they work as a series of these settlements together, which are like work like assembly line. And what happens is, so this might be packaging, this might be riveting. So they take place in one of these, and as the cycle goes around, they get manufactured. That's how. So here you see a dyeing industry which happens inside these informal settlement. This is a press which works in an informal settlement. This is a family-based enterprise which happens there. And this again, you see the ground floor being used for enterprise with the top space is being used for living. So there are these complexities which actually manifest itself in this place. It will be more richer than that also. And I'm just showing you some. Just like architects, we understood different types of housing and how they get manifested in terms of plan. So right from these row houses to individual houses to shared houses in various conditions. That's again which happened there. We understood how they grow and what materials they use. So they start with a basic land and how they actually start with basic construction techniques and the basic unit they put together. And later they might grow vertically also. That's how they grow. And as you see, these ladders take you to the top. So that's the way they incrementally grow and evolve. It's not that they come as one unit together at one point. They always grow incrementally, and that's a lot of learning for us, because generally we as architects have been taught to design objects which are finished, but the whole idea of growth, somebody working with our own forms to change it, is not something palatable to architects. And obviously we learned from like working with a lot of anthropologists, lot of like, and that's been our school also. We work with filmmakers, we work with people who are artists, and some of the things we learn from them while working with the settlements are the immense amount of narratives, rich narratives that you find. The immense amount of characters. Just as you have typology of buildings, you have typology of characters here. And this is just one of our students who had made a more of a representation of a character that they were studying. This is a boy and his engagement with the city, and how slowly through time he becomes successful, and how during that time, what is the meaning of the house, the home, and how it changes. So this is one type of narrative. There could be many such narratives, and what it does explains to you the different set of people, the different set of characters that inhabit such spaces, and what home means for them. So that's I think something that humbles us, because that gives us an understanding that we can't homogenize cities. Cities are for a lot of people. It allows for diversity. It allows for an equitable, and it's liberating also. For everybody, it's liberating. That's how. That's the reason why you come to cities, because it gives you a space to be liberated, and such stories tell you about the stories of how you get liberated through these. So, and some of our design projects actually work with such characters and understand the notion of house and living. And when you put them together, you get a landscape of such houses which do different things. Just to give you an example, this is a house of an entrepreneur who's involved in selling potatoes, and how the house would mean for them, what design would mean for them. And as I said, as you put them together, these could be the various responses which are there for their housing. So clearly this is a slide for architects, and what it helps us do is actually make us think about all of these things. Okay, when we learn from informality, it helps us rethink our process of mapping, our process of representation, very important, because I think we need to look at representation completely. Sometimes we find that the modes of visual representation that we learn can be very limiting to understand these spatial systems. It helps us actually frame new analytical tools. Obviously, design strategies need to be reformulated, because you can't work only in the studio. What are incremental design strategies? We are not yet trained to it, because we always want to control the object. We want total control of the object. So the idea of what is the soft form is very interesting to such settlements. And also, like, how do you conceive informality in terms of making these policies for housing? So I'll show you a demonstration of our students' work. This is not in Mumbai, but it is in another part of city in the eastern part of the country, which is in Bhuvaneshwar, Cuttack. And this is a settlement which is along the canal. It's a linear settlement. I'll show you the map soon. It's a linear settlement along the canal. We had gone here, and again we were working with community-based organization. That's how we were allowed entry here. They had done preliminary mapping of this place, mainly in terms of the people, but they had not done a spatial mapping. So we worked closely with them to do a spatial mapping, with the students to do a spatial mapping. And these are some of the visuals of the place. This is the type of activities they are involved in. The surrounding areas are very extremely important work areas. They have bazaars nearby. So that's the type of activity. You can see the canal. So that's the linear stretch. That's the houses. So all are row houses along the canal. That's what it is, all row houses along the canal. So just to show you some, so that's the type of activity they're involved. They are involved with washing. The canal becomes their lifeline. So that's the front yard, that's the backyard. So these are thin houses completely, one having a road in between and the other facing the canal side. That's the typology which comes up. So we had closely worked, and that's how they use the interior spaces. So a lot of it is recycling. So that's to show you how they are involved in, and now I'll take you. To the design response. So what the student does, just to give you an example of what the site is about, these are the complex water systems of the city, and this is one of the canal where the site is located. And these are rivers in the city. That's where the rivers are dammed, and the water is taken through these canals. And as you see the site is here, that the yellow marks the site, that's the canal, that's the site. So what you see as the settlement was this linear stretch along the, and so they are very untenable properties. These are properties which are flood prone. The government is not going to resettle them for the next 15 years to come, 10 to 15 years to come. Yet what can architecture do? Because for 10 to 15 years, you cannot leave them to live like this. Okay, so the students were then studying various possibilities of what could be done with these areas, and this is the location. It's a very important location with bazaars, railway stations, vegetable markets nearby. Okay, so what the students did, the students obviously analyzed the settlement. They understood what is the income of these areas, what are the household size. Very important, as you see the house size, just 30 to 60 square feet, four people staying in one house, and the average age between 15 to 59, lot diversity in terms of age also. House types, lot of it are what are called temporary houses, kaccha houses they're called in that local language, temporary houses. Only 15% is some sort of materials which are permanent in nature. Otherwise, all are made with temporary materials. So 95% of the house still use firewood. Average income as low as, I was saying, $50 per month. That's the amount of income that they have. Okay, and just to see infrastructure, how do they get water? What do they do with toilets? So that's the type of analysis the students were doing. And so what we understood from a lot of these interviews is that more than architectural solution, what you need is to augment income. Because with this income, clearly they would not be able to. So the students studied some of the local policies of the place, what can be, how they can harness them, and how they can synergize them. So as I've said, this is the complete mapping of the linear thing. All the families were studied, understood in terms of income, what income they have, what work they do. So what work they do, how they're involved in, what are their household, what do they have in the house. So this whole settlement was mapped for that. All these sections were to understand relationship with land. And then the student came up with a proposal. So the idea was clearly to augment income. So how would they augment income? Like the idea was looking at their skills, looking at what they're capable of doing and what is happening presently. A lot of possibilities of urban farming happens because there are vegetable markets nearby. Okay, a lot of them can be getting involved in poultry. And a lot of this are because there are money being made available by governments to augment these two. And we said that if this augmentation happens, the people can improve their houses. Though they are temporary, they can improve their houses. Very simple proposal, you build with bamboo, which is the local material, and you lift the houses from top so that, first of all, it gives you a flood protection. Also, the space down can be used for livelihood activities, and you stay on top. So that was the clear proposal that this student was involved with, and how they could build this, what is the cost involved with it. They were working again with the people, with the community, to see how this can be done, how their waste can be treated, how toilets can be built, which are not individual but shared. And the idea of urban farming, how they could get involved in it, and what type of training would be required, because it's something that the community-based organizations would be involved in. So that's the proposal. That's the first stage of the settlement. So as the settlement, as people have money, some of them would actually improve their houses and actually lift them up. And these are places where they would build amenities like toilets, more common infrastructure where land was available, where it opened up. And that would serve the purpose of shared toilets. These are places where urban farming along strips could be done, and also probably the grey water can be reused for that. So these are the proposals the students were involved in. Not that they are the best of proposals, but to show you that those are type of thinking that the students were involved in. And just to tell you that with this, we are actually now closely involved with the city government. City government has seen this proposal. We are actually involved with the city government. And we are being funded by a very a trust called the Tata Trust to actually take it forward, to formulate it more, not towards materialization probably, because materialization, they might get it done by somebody else, but towards actually how they can be given more shape. So that's what we are involved in now through the school. I think with that I would end, and I'll take in questions from you.